Hi, I'm Amy Baudette from the altE store. Thank you for watching our video series. This video is called Designing a Grid-Tied Solar Electric System. If you missed our previous videos, I recommend you go back and watch the earlier ones in the series to get a good foundation as they discuss the individual components in more detail. In this video, we're going to walk through how to select the equipment for your grid-tied system, including the solar panels, racking, overcurrent protection, and inverter. But first, here's a quick overview of a grid-tied system. It's the most common solar system installed in locations that have electricity already available from the utility company. A grid-tied system simply takes the power generated from the solar panels during the day and uses it real-time in your house. If you have any extra power available, it sells that power back to the grid for a credit. And at nights, or in days when you don't generate enough power, you can use that credit to buy power back from the grid. Any more power needed is just bought as usual from the electric company. Let's go over how to size the different components. And don't worry, you don't have to do this alone. A professional installer can figure this out for you, or you can call us at altE Store to do the system design for you. But for those of you interested in how to design a system yourself, let's go through the main steps. A peek behind the curtain, if you will. First, you need to determine how much power you currently use, if this is for an existing house. From your current monthly bill, you can figure out how much power you use a day. Based on your location and the amount of sun you get, you can determine the size of the solar array needed. From there, you figure out what racking, inverter, and breakers you need. Let's go through each of these steps. First, how much power do you use? Take a look at your electric bill. It's generally billed by the month. You can see here on this bill, it is higher in the summer due to using the air conditioner. If we had electric heat, you might have seen higher bills in the winter instead. The nice thing about higher usage in the summer is that that is when there is also the most solar energy available. From this bill, add up all of the monthly kilowatt hours and divide it by 365 to get daily kilowatt hour average. In my case, that's 50.6 kilowatt hours a day. We'll use that daily kilowatt hour number to size the solar array, but first we need to figure out how much sun you get on average. Insolation maps show the available sun hours for your area. This map of the United States gives you a good idea of the solar potential. The darker the color, the better the sunshine. Obviously, the Southwest and Hawaii are best for solar. But even locations not known for their sunshine, like New England and the Pacific Northwest, still have enough sunshine on average to make for a very good solar solution. Here's a quick peek to see how different regions of the world compare. For our calculations, we need a more accurate number than what I can see on the map. There are several online sources available to find more specifics for your area. This chart shows for my area near Worcester, Massachusetts. You can see the monthly versus the annual average numbers. For a grid-tied system, since I'm just supplementing the electricity I buy so that I can buy less, I'm just going to use the average number. The ideal angle for installing solar is latitude, but my roof isn't that steep, and I'm just going to mount them flush without tilting them up. So I'm going to use latitude minus 15 degrees row. The good news is, for my location, I'll get the same amount of power as if I was at the ideal angle. Because we don't live in an ideal world, I also need to take into consideration less than ideal conditions. Generally, for a grid-tied system, we calculate that we will lose about 23% due to losses in the system, from voltage drop in the wires to bird poop on the panels. Now let's do some math. We take that average daily kilowatt hours from earlier, multiply it by 1,000 to get watt hours, divide it by your annual average sun hours to get 11,254 watts. We divide that by 77% to take into account the system losses we just discussed, which gives us 14,615 watts of solar to provide 100% of our electricity needs. As I said earlier, most grid-tied systems don't try to make all of their power, just cut their existing bill. So for this example, I'm going to cut that in half to provide half of my electricity with solar. so I need a solar array of about 7,300 watts. Now let's use this information to pick out the rest of the system. Grid-tied inverters are sized based on the size of the solar array they are connected to. There is a certain window of number of panels in series and parallel that will work with the inverter. When selecting the inverter, you'll find that most inverter manufacturers these days have an online calculator called a string sizer to help select the right inverter for your panels. We'll walk through ABB's string sizer to find the right inverter and panel configuration. I enter the temperatures that the panels will be seeing during daylight hours, and if I'm mounting them on a roof or on the ground. This matters because the solar panel's voltage changes pretty dramatically based on temperature, so the string sizer needs to be able to calculate the highest and lowest voltages it will see. I'm also selecting the solar panels I'm going to use. I picked Kyocera's 250-watt panels. They're a terrific panel at a very good price. Since I'm looking at around 7,300 watts of solar, I picked the ABB Uno 7.6 kilowatt inverter. I can see that depending on how many parallel strings I do, I can use series strings of anywhere from 4 to 14 long in a row. However, these may not be the ideal string lengths for best efficiency. If there are any warnings, the string sizer will alert you in a note. I picked two sets of two strings of 8 for a total of 8,000 watts. The inverter is very happy with that size. It's a little bigger than my 7,300 watts that I calculated that I needed, so it will actually generate more than half my power. So now I've got 32 Kyocera 250-watt panels and an ABB Uno 7.6K transformerless inverter. So how will I mount them? Luckily for those of us doing a lot of designs, Iron Ridge also has a time-saving design assistant to help you speed up your design work. They've got one for roof mounts and one for ground mounts. We'll walk through the roof mount one. You enter what solar panels you're using, how many, and how they are laid out. I'm doing two rows of 16 flush against the roof. For my area, the building code requires the system be designed to withstand 100 mile an hour winds and a snow load of 40 psi. For 4 foot spacing between the mounting feet, which lines up with every other rafter, it tells me I can use the Iron Ridge XR100 rails. Just a few more inputted details, like what color clamps to match the panels, and it outputs a bill of materials with the manufacturer's suggested retail price. They do suggest a flashing for asphalt shingled roofs, so if you have a different type of shingle, you may need a different flashing to prevent leaks. The last piece is overcurrent protection, protecting your system in the event something goes wrong. In a grid-tied system, there are two locations we need to put in overcurrent protection, on the DC side by the solar panels and on the AC side in the mains breaker box. The combiner box I chose for this system is a disconnecting combiner box. It allows you to turn off power coming out of the panels right by the array in compliance with NEC 2014 rapid shutdown requirement. Each string of panels gets its own fuse in the combiner box. The data sheet of the panel usually tells you what size fuses to use. For grid-tied panels under 300 watts, it's usually 15 amps. To calculate it yourself, you take the solar panel's short circuit current and multiply it by 1.56. That gets you 14.1 amps, rounded up to 15 amps. The combiner box wires the strings into parallel and gives you a place to transition the wire into conduit to make the run down to the inverter. It's also a good place to put the lightning arrester. The AC output of the inverter goes into dual pole breaker in your home's main breaker box. To calculate the size breaker to get, you take the watts of the inverter, in this case 7,600 watts, divide it by the AC voltage output, 240 volts, and multiply it by 1.25 to oversize it for NEC's requirement for devices being used for more than 3 hours continuous. This gives you a 40-amp dual-pole AC breaker that you add to your main breaker box. So what have we got for our system? We have a combiner box with four 15-amp fuses, 32 of the Kyocera 250-watt panels wired four strings of 8, an ABB 7.6-kilowatt transformerless inverter, and just over 200 feet of Iron Ridge XR100 rail with the end clamps and mounting feet. you're also going to be selecting the flashing that you need for your particular roof. Then you would get a 40-amp AC dual pole breaker that fits into your main breaker box. So let's look at a schematic to see how this all fits together. We have four parallel strings of 8 panels in series going to a combiner box with a 15-amp fuse for each string and a lightning arrestor. The combined strings are sent in conduit to the inverter. The AC output of the inverter may be required by your electric company to go to a lockable AC disconnect near your meter so that the lineman can turn off the system if needed. It then goes to a 40-amp breaker in your mains breaker box to your house. Then any excess power goes to your bidirectional meter, which will be spinning backwards or forwards, depending on if you're selling or buying power. From there, it goes right out to the grid. As a nice starting point, altE stores put together package deals that include most of the equipment needed for a solar install. We have grid-tied, off-grid, and grid-tied battery backup systems pre-designed. We're able to customize them to fit your specific needs. For example, if you want to change out the layout of the panels, switch to a different brand panel or inverter, and select the correct flashing for your roof, that's very simple to do. This package here lines up nicely with the example we just walked through. This has the pricing as of November of 2014. Pricing and availability is, of course, subject to change. Here's a list of what's included in the package. We don't include conduit and wire from the roof to inside, or the wiring and breaker on the AC output of the inverter, as that's common electrical equipment that you would need to buy locally based on your requirements. The package also doesn't include the flashing for the roof, as we need to know what kind of roof you have. Then the appropriate flashing can be added as we work out the details with you. So that should give you a good feel for what's involved with designing a residential grid-tied system. To get you started for your house, altE Store has got a bunch of calculators available online, including the grid-tied calculator. We also have many other package systems we've already designed as a starting point, allowing you to customize them for your particular needs. Also check out more of our video series on our website. We've got a team of highly trained technical sales reps available to help you plan your system. Give us a call. And don't forget to check out the rest of our site at altestore.com, where we are making renewable doable.